Hello and welcome to St. John's. We are certainly glad that you have tuned in to join us for worship. Our worship begins as we live. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
What a wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul. What a wondrous love is this, O my soul. What a wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul. I'll sing on, and when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing His love for me, and through eternity I'll sing on, I'll sing on, and through eternity I'll sing.
We continue with the Kyrie. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you declare your almighty power above all in showing mercy and pity. Mercifully grant us such a measure of your grace that we may obtain your gracious promises and be made partakers of your heavenly treasures. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our reading from the Old Testament is taken from the prophet Jeremiah in the 7th chapter. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim this message there. Hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah, coming through this gate to worship the Lord. This is what the Lord of armies, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I will establish you in this place. Do not trust in deceptive words and say, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. If you truly reform your ways and your actions, if you execute justice between a man and his neighbor, if you do not oppress the foreigner, the orphan, or the widow, if you do not shed innocent blood in this place, if you do not follow after other gods to your own ruin, then I will let you live in this place, in the land I gave your forefathers forever and ever. Listen, you are trusting in deceptive words that are not helpful. Will you steal and commit murder? Commit adultery and swear falsely, offering sacrifices to Baal and following other gods you do not know? And will you come and stand before me in this temple that bears my name and say, we are saved, only to do all these detestable things? This house bears my name. Have you made it a den of robbers? Listen, I myself have been watching, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Our reading from the epistles of the New Testament is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. St. Paul writes, now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were deceived and somehow led away to mute idols. Therefore, I am informing you that no one speaking by God's Spirit says, a curse upon Jesus. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are various kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are various kinds of service, and yet the same Lord. There are various kinds of activity, but the same God who produces all of them in everyone. Each person is given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one person, a message of wisdom is given by the Spirit. To another, a message of knowledge, as the same Spirit provides it. By the same Spirit, faith is given to someone else, and to another, the same Spirit gives healing gifts. Another is given powers to do miracles. Another, the gift of prophecy. Another, the evaluating of spirits. Someone else, different kinds of tongues. And another, the interpretation of tongues. One and the same Spirit produces all of these, distributing them to each one individually as God desires. This is the word of the Lord. Our reading from the Holy Gospels is taken from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 16. As Jesus came near, he saw the city and wept over it. He said, if you, yes you, had only known on this day the things that would bring peace to you, but now it is hidden from your eyes. In fact, the days will come upon you when your enemies will build on an embankment against you, surround you, and hem you in on every side. Within your walls, they will dash you and your children to the ground. And within your walls, they will not leave one stone on top of another, because you did not recognize the time when God came to help you. Jesus entered the temple courts and began to drive out those who were selling things there. He told them, it is written, My house will be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. Every day he was teaching in the temple courts, but the chief priests, the experts in the law, and the leaders of the people continued to look for a way to put him to death. They could not find any way to do it, because all the people were clinging to him and listening. This is the word of the Lord. Please join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory, to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like
like our God. There is no one like you, God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done. We believe in you, God. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done here.
In the name of Jesus, amen. Today we are looking at what is one of the most famous passages of Scripture, certainly one of the most famous passages in the New Testament. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, when St. Paul delineates for the church spiritual gifts and what they mean. And so today we take a closer look at that. And so remember that as Paul writes to the church in Corinth, he is writing to a city that is not unlike the United States of America in our day. Very cosmopolitan, pluralistic society, a lot of wealth, a lot of resources, a lot of means, also a lot of arrogance, a lot of strife, a lot of difficulties, a lot of factions. And so the context is not that far removed from ours. And so he begins, he says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be uninformed." Remember, these are folks who did not grow up knowing the Lord their God, but they grew up worshiping a variety of other gods as the ancient world was full of various gods that were worshiped by the people. And in Paul's day and age, the Roman Empire is the ruling authority over all these areas. And one of the things with Rome is they were not opposed to religion. They loved religion, and they wanted to add as many as they could. As you know, they took many of the Greek gods and just gave them different names. And they were particularly interested in old religions, ancient religions. And for them, it seems the more the better. And so these folks did not grow up knowing the Lord God as Paul did. And so he's saying, "Now I want to explain to you what spiritual gifts are, because you don't know what this is yet." He says, "You know that when you were pagans," and there's nothing negative about this. This is not a moniker implying any kind of judgment or anything. It's been taken over in our usage to mean something ungodly or just a very negative thing, pagan. The word is certainly a neutral word, and he's speaking of those who followed pagan religions. "But when you were pagans, you were deceived and somehow led away to mute idols." A mute idol is a man-made god. In the ancient world, they would fashion for themselves out of wood or stone or metal gods, and they would bow down and worship to them. We see in the book of Judges that there was a fella who did an unbelievably rotten thing. He stole a great deal of silver from his mother, and then she put a curse on the person who stole it, and so he came back, and this isn't a grown man who did this, but he came back and said, "You know that silver that was stolen, I took it." And he gave it back to her, and she was so grateful that her son came clean. It's very sad. This was a grown man. But she sets aside a portion of it, of the silver, to have a god made for him. And he takes that god, and he puts it in his house, and he assigns his sons to be priests as they worship this god and believe that this god is providing great things. They don't talk. They don't move. They do very little. They just sit there. I mean, these things, these gods that they were making, had less powers than a Barbie doll or a G.I. Joe figure. And I'm embarrassed to say that in my day and age, G.I. Joe was a lot bigger. He was the same size as Barbie, but over the years, he shrunk a great deal, which I guess happens to all of us. But these gods had less capacity than an action figure or a Barbie doll, in that at least Barbie and G.I. Joe can move their, well, we move their arms for them, but you can reposition them. Something you carve out of a piece of stone, it's pretty much in a fixed position and can't be moved. And this is what they worship. This is what they look to as their God. This is what they were seeking when they inquired of what they believed was the divine, the otherworldly, and that which would provide for them. He says, "You were deceived and somehow led away to mute idols. Therefore, I am informing you, I'm giving you information, that no one speaking by God's Spirit says, 'A curse be upon Jesus.' And no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord,' except by the Holy Spirit." What this teaches us is that anyone who curses the Lord Jesus Christ does not have the Holy Spirit within them. They are apart from God. And it's also the case, whoever does confess him as Lord, if you confess Jesus Christ, and I know not everybody who watches our broadcast believe in Christ Jesus, but for those who believe in Christ Jesus, you do this because the Holy Spirit is the one bringing this forth from your heart. And for those who don't believe, we pray that you will receive the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will create faith in Christ Jesus within you. Paul says, no one can say Jesus is Lord. What an assurance it is. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. If you believe, you have the Holy Spirit. You need not doubt that God dwells within you. He goes on to say, now, there are various kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. And in that context, gifts mean to them the same thing they do to us. Things that are simply given to us apart from any merit, achievement, or earning on our part. It's something that is simply given to us. He says there are various gifts, but the same Spirit. And he's speaking into a pluralistic world in which many of these gods did different things. And so many people would collect unto themselves many different gods. And so some might worship Baal because Baal provided fertility. And Baal was pretty outdated by the time that Paul is writing. So really, I'm stretching it a bit. But you have Artemis and you have Athena and a whole host of other gods, Zeus, you name it. But they each specialized in something. Just like today, there seems to be less and less general practitioners among physicians and many, many more specialists. That's the way it was with their gods. You sought this god out if you were going to be doing a public speech and you were concerned about your performance. If you were going to be traveling on the sea, there was a different god who would look after you there. And if there were concerns about your crops, again, one of the fertility gods, they would help you. And so one would have many gods that they would worship because they did different things. Paul says, let me lay this on you. There are various gifts given to each of us, and they're different. But get this, Paul says, there's only one Spirit who grants these gifts. And so no matter what your gifts are and how they differ from one another, it is the same Spirit providing them. There is a unity here, and he's going to unpack the reason for the unity. He says there are different gifts of ministries. I'm sorry, different kinds of ministries, and yet the same Lord. There are various kinds of activity, but the same God who produces all of them in everyone. They have not known, the majority of them, a do-all-things kind of God. They've only known the specialist divines, if you will. Paul says, there's only one God. Anything good in this world is coming from him. He goes on to say, each person is given a manifestation. I could do without the word manifestation because I don't use it anywhere else except for when we're reading from Scripture. But it's to show forth something, to bring it about, that one can see it, behold it, know what it is. And so he says that each person is given a showing forth, something you can see of the Spirit, for the common good. The gifts that we receive are not meant to be hoarded by us, for us to be the people who benefit from these exclusively, but for everyone. And for that reason, God spreads the gifts out. And so no one is given all the gifts. No matter how talented one is, they do not possess all the gifts. But the gifts are spread out among us. Maybe it seems sometimes disproportionately, but they are varied gifts and they're spread out. What does that tell us? It tells us that we cannot function properly. We won't have all the gifts if we don't have everyone. It is often said that you need the church, and the church needs you. Sometimes the second clause gets lost in translation because there's so much emphasis on you need the church, because eternal life is a pretty big deal. You need the gifts of God, His Word, and the sacraments, which forgive your sins, strengthen and nourish your faith, enabling you to continue to believe in Christ Jesus unto salvation. But we do not want to give any impression or idea that the church doesn't really need you. I'm sorry to say that many times in the church, the people in the church have given that impression by the way they have treated others, or by the way that they fail to acknowledge the gifts that others bring. But there's no question, when Paul takes up this topic in Romans chapter 12, one of the things that's handy is he deals specifically with spiritual gifts in Romans 12 and in 1 Corinthians 12. He picks it up again in 2 Corinthians, but it's not in the 12th chapter, so that's a difficulty. But in Romans, he compares it to a body. How there are various parts of the body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Because without the hand, the eye is powerless to bring forward to itself the things that it beholds, the things that it sees and perceives. You need the church, and the church needs you. We need everyone's gifts. Now he says, to one person, a message of wisdom is given by the Spirit. To another, a message of knowledge. Sometimes that throws us, but we got to really get down to brass tacks of distinguishing wisdom and knowledge. I'm going to do it real quick for you. Did you ever know someone who was just brimming full of stuff? They had all kinds of know-how, all kinds of things, and they constantly were throwing it at other people's faces. They were failing to recognize how their superiority of knowledge made others feel somehow less. That's a lack of wisdom. That's foolish, the opposite of wisdom. And so there you go, the distinction between knowledge and wisdom. Not everybody who possesses great knowledge has the wisdom, sometimes the wisdom to use that knowledge. And not everyone who is wise is brimming over with knowledge. One of the things you will notice in your life as you grow older is that the years force a certain amount of wisdom upon us, whether we want it or not. We grow from experiences. Life teaches us many things, and that is wisdom. But in addition to giving spirits of knowledge and wisdom, Paul says, additionally, the same Spirit provides them both. And by the same Spirit, faith is given to someone else. And to another, the same Spirit gives healing gifts. Think of our physicians, nurses, all manner of medical practitioners, nurses' assistants, paramedics, various forms of first responders. Another is given powers to do miracles. Another, the gift of prophecy. These two are rather tricky. In Paul's day and age, he restored a man named Eutychus who was sitting on the windowsill, and Paul was preaching late into the night, and Eutychus unfortunately fell asleep and slipped off the window, fell to his death, and Paul went down and raised him from the dead. And so we often speak of Saint Eutychus, the patron saint of those who fall asleep in church. I'm kidding. If Eutychus falls to the ground in our place, to his death, he's in trouble, because I do not have miraculous powers, and I'm not aware of anyone since the apostles who possessed these things. The same is true with the gift of prophecy. Prophecy is to receive a word from God, and in this context it was understood a direct word from God. Weekly, I bring to you a word from God, but that word is not downloaded to me by our Lord, but I receive it through the Holy Scriptures. Much prayer goes into these messages, but also much study. My brain is not a blank canvas upon which the Lord writes and I simply speak forth, but it was the case in those days. And so in these days, we can be prophetic, speaking a word of God that challenges the accepted order, challenges values that contradict Scripture, but a special word given for us to share with others? Can God do it? You better believe it. Does He do it? I've never seen it. As the writer of Hebrews tells us, as he opens his book, the book of Hebrews, in many and various ways God spoke to His people of old by the prophets, but now, in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son. We have the Word of God. Jesus Christ and His Word is the full revelation of God. No additional word is needed, because anything taught in the name of God must be examined against the Word of God. If it contradicts it, it must be rejected. If it affirms the Word of God and agrees with it, it's hardly necessary. We already have the Word of God. They're saying the same things. So don't be looking for miracles and prophecy. Although, I will tell you this, I have seen many the miracle, and that miracle was worked through prayer and through God's use of people's talents, knowledge, and ability, all God-given gifts. Furthermore, to another, the evaluating of spirits. Someone who's discerning, someone who has that sense, is this from God or is this not from God? Is this evil or this is good? And again, the Scriptures are our guide there in the Holy Spirit. Someone else, different kinds of tongues. Please don't think about this in the physical sense, and don't be looking around at your neighbor to see, who is it among us that's received three tongues? You won't find them, I'm sorry. You just won't. Because Paul's speaking of languages, like we speak of somebody's primary language or their first language as their mother tongue. Various tongues. I might even compare this to, you know, people who are trilingual or multilingual. That's a gift from God. Takes a whole lot of hard work, but a gift from God for that inherent ability. And another, the interpretation of tongues. One and the same Spirit produces all of these, distributing them to each one individually as He desires. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. If you count them up, there's 9 spiritual gifts listed here. This does not mean that there are only 9 spiritual gifts. That's it. I believe that this is one of the reasons that Paul, as he unpacks spiritual gifts here, 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, and again in his second letter to the Corinthians, actually makes different lists. Yes, there's overlap, but the lists are not identical and they're not always 9. That's to help us get the message, whoa, these are gifts, but they are not the only gifts. But these gifts, all of them, whatever they be, Maybe it's music, literary expression. Maybe it's mechanical abilities. Maybe it's generosity. Maybe it's compassion, a listening ear. All kinds of different gifts. Paul says they all come from the same God. We do not do the specialty gods. One God and one God alone. And he gives all these things. And he gives different gifts to different people, Paul says. Why? Because all of them are needed. But you're not going to find them in one or two people. You're not going to find them in one or two people. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name, Jesus says in Matthew 18, I am there among them. That is true. Wherever two or three people are gathered in his name, he is there in spirit. But that doesn't mean that you have a church. It doesn't mean you have a church just because you have two or three people gathered in his name. But you can. We spoke last week about the seven marks of the church. If you have all those seven marks and you're two people, you have the church. But as you know, the church is marked typically by a fullness of God's gifts. If there are two of us, it is not going to be as robust or God-pleasing as if there are 45 or 4,500. The gifts that are given to each one may be sometimes difficult to discern and figure out what those are. A good place to start is praying. Show me, Lord, what gifts you give to me. A second place to start, what are you passionate about? What works good for you? What do people tend to praise you for? Or what do people first notice in you? That may be a spiritual gift. And then to ask yourself, how am I using these gifts for the church? And before you even ask that question, let's qualify what the church is. Because we are so rooted in the United States to church buildings. When people think of church, they think little white frame building with a pointy steeple at the top, maybe a cross. Church. Search for church clip art. Church. Read the New Testament. If Google image search was working only on what it knows about from the New Testament, and you searched church, you would not get a picture of a building with a pointy steeple and cross at the top. If it was informed by the New Testament, you would see crowds of people. You would see people gathered together in a sense of unity and purpose, studying the Word of God. And so when Paul speaks of these gifts given to each one in different ways and different measures, but for the common good, it's for the whole community. As you think about your gifts, how God is calling you to use your gifts, make no mistake, you have been given gifts. Make no mistake of that. Again, make no mistake, you are called by God to use those gifts for the common good. And as you consider, how can I use these gifts in the service of the church? Don't just think about our building. Though we need people to use their gifts in caring for our building, caring for our altars, so many other things, but there's so much more. There's so much more. Too many times, people are unable to see the spiritual gifts that are given to them for God's service to the church, because it doesn't seem to fit the context of the church building and church activities. And so they look at people who are able to do all kinds of building trades work and keep up the building, those who pay careful attention to detail and work with the altar guild, those who have the gift of teaching, helping out in Sunday school, those who are very outgoing, who serve as greeters and ushers and all these other things. Those are gifts. But more gifts are given. If the church is going to experience the fullness that is the church, remember, not a frame building with a pointy steeple, but the people of God. And in the Lutheran faith, we confess in our Augsburg Confession, this is what we state, the bottom line of what we believe. Article 7, the church is the assembly of believers among whom the gospel is purely preached and the sacraments are administered according to the word of God. Nothing about buildings. It's the assembly of believers gathered around God's word and his sacraments. The people of God need your gift. I can't tell you how many times dentists, nurses, and physicians have served the people of God when I have taken people who need care and can't afford it and have hooked us up with some treatment at very little cost or many times no cost at all. They write it off. They say, Pastor, don't worry about it. I got this. People who know mechanics who I've gone to and said, you know, I have somebody who just started a new job. The car is conking out on them. They need assistance. And they were helped. People that I knew needed a friend, somebody more for more interaction and conversation than I'm able to give, and I could say to someone else in the church, can you pal up to that person? Can you spend time with them? And from that, a friendship comes forth. As we close, because I know you got the message and I don't want to belabor this, as we close, what we see here is Paul says, you folks have been worshiping idols, things that don't talk, things that don't hear, things that don't see. Let me tell you about the living God. And get this, the living God, through your baptism, has come to dwell within you, the Holy Spirit. And he doesn't just sit in there, waiting around to catch you doing something ungodly. He activates something in your life, many things. He brings transformation of your heart, transformation of your lives, and suddenly your hands, feet, and mouth are moving in the rhythm of Christ as he brings forth his gifts. I can't tell you how many times I have seen the work that a person has done for others or for the church. And not only thanked them, but thanked God that he sent us this person. There are many people, for a whole host of hurtful reasons and other complications, that are outside of the church. We pray that we will receive you back to the church because you need the gifts that God wants to give you through his word and his sacraments and through the fellowship of believers. But what's more, we are incomplete until you join us. Without the gifts that God has given you, we are without those gifts. The church is called to take seriously the need for all, and that means all. Christ died for all. The sins of all who believe in him are forgiven. And we need all, if we are to be complete, or as complete as an imperfect church can be in an imperfect world. But a perfect God has forgiven your sins daily, washes away your sins because Jesus died in your place and answered for your sins. As he fills you with joy and gratitude and peace, take a look around and notice how he is also using you to bless others with that same peace, forgiveness, and grace. In the name of Jesus, amen.
The wine and the bread and the sons of
Please join me in praying the prayer taught by our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the prayers of the church this week, each of the petitions I will speak will conclude, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you to please respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Heavenly Father, keep us, your baptized children, as the apple of your eye, and hide us in the shadow of your wings. Turn us from all false doctrine, whereby your holy name is blasphemed and profaned. Give ear to our prayers for mercy, and forgive our sins for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, fill your vineyard with faithful laborers, O Lord. Bless them with your wisdom, that they would be faithful stewards of your mysteries, making known your gracious visitation in the Holy Word and sacraments, which deliver eternal salvation to those who hear and receive in faith. Lord, in your mercy, defend your church throughout the world, O Lord. Give strength to our brothers and sisters in Christ who experience persecution, and turn the hearts of your enemies that they would be brought to repentance and faith and joined to the fellowship of all believers. Lord, in your mercy, give us hearts to recognize that all that we have comes from your gracious provisions, and keep us faithful when we have more than we need, that we would be generous in our tithes and offerings and in our assistance of those who need help. Lord, in your mercy, bless the relief agencies of our synods and all other groups who provide relief and aid to those in need. Let compassion and mercy be their guiding light, and give wisdom and discernment to those who administer those agencies, that their use of resources would be wise and beneficial. Lord, in your mercy, bless Donald, our president, Tony, our governor, all those who make and administer our laws, and all judges, that they might serve our country faithfully and make decisions with wisdom. Defend all who serve in our military and give courage to both them and their families. Lord, in your mercy, support and strengthen those who are sick or suffering, particularly those whom we have named on our prayer list and those we now name in the thoughts of our hearts. In the midst of their trials, keep them always focused upon Christ and the everlasting hope they have in Him. And if it be your will, restore them to physical health and strength. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.